You are experiencing a world which is full of multidimensional entities with varieties of actions, contrary to each other, interdependent, interlocked, interrelated, and this medley is experienced by varieties of people. But only those who are curious, only those who are blessed with such an innovative intelligence through which they are willing to know about something and understand the formula, that as it has been clearly told by a very great analyst as well as a cosmogonist. He is known as Peter Deaveras. He told, the whole universal analytical table is inside a safe, and no doubt the safe has a combination. But the problem is the combination itself is locked inside the safe. So this world is considered to be an opportunity for sojourning with our requirements properly gratified, as well as looking our routinal way of life with our limited desires or designations or destinations. But few of the people, either they may be scientists, they may be the spiritual people, they are interested in understanding something. Something within the limitations, something beyond the limitations. What is what? What is the basic structure and substratum of the world? These are all the questions which are commonly there in the mind of people, those who are blessed with creative, curious, incentive, innovative and unlimited transcendental intelligence. So these people are engaged continuously in the process of understanding some basic concepts, and they are giving either prayojana, that is immediate effect, para prayojana, long term benefit, then parama prayojana, which is the eternal benefit or total emancipation from the hurdles or the perpetual cycles of melancholy. So there are different types of people. So unanimously they started with the functioning of the world. There are two types of functioning. One is the inanimate objects like earth and other celestial elements, along with the galaxies, super galaxial elements, starting with the basic particles. They are very punctual. You see, we are living beings. We are governed by some process of intelligence to maintain precision, perfection and punctuality. But more than us, that which is said to be inanimate, that is more punctual, more systematic. Systematism, punctuality, precision, these are all the attributes or qualities of highly precise and well sophisticated living beings or models. But more than these enhanced models, these normal achetana or inanimate beings, they are more perfect and they have all the characters which are explained for a culminated status of life. They all classify that these inanimate objects having an order of motion, rotation, fixation, revolution, collision, explosion, inception, all of these things are then cosmogony. So these things are entirely different. What is the purpose or what is the second step of the universal explosion or expansion? They started with life. First they started with the whole universe and the process. They found that lot of particles are there, they are moving, they are exploded, they are doing everything. So what is the ultimatum? So what is the wonder created by the universal process? The wonder that is created by the universal process is life. And there is a science known as biosis, and also there is a science known as exobiosis. The biosis deals with the evolution of life inside our earth. Exobiosis is a study of exploring the possibilities of living beings in various parts of the other planetary systems and the same planetary system. Whether a homogeneous or heterogeneous or metagenous or contagenous or conagenous particles, they exist. Such a type of life system exists in the other planets or not. Just they are just exploring, and there are a lot of fabulous and fictional pseudosciences which is dealing with the paranormal phenomena of a martial living being, then martial invasion. There are a lot of fictional stories against that. Then UFO, you know, that unidentified flying objects, they are still in exploration. So they first start with understanding of life, organizing life, then nurturing the life and processing the life, as well as fortifying the life from the dangers of life. Janma Mrityu Jara Vyadhi, birth, death, old ageness, along with the maladies or the diseases. So these are all the unavoidable stages of degradation in life. So first, what is the origin of life? Why to find the origin of life? Only if you find the origin of life, then unless you find the basic element of any product, you cannot get any benefit, number one. you cannot remove any hindrance. Even if you get any benefit or remove any hindrance, that will be an interim project that cannot give you permanent solution. So, according to science of ontology, any person who knows the basic karanam tu dhyayaha is the Upanishad Vakya. Whatever may be there, the basic primordial causative element, unless it is understood, utmost benefit or utmost solution or dissolution from the so-called obstacles under lineage and consequential barrier cannot be overruled. So they must know about the fundamental. Now we are in the process of understanding the origin of life, the behavior of life, and what are the hindrances in the processing of life, how to overrule them, and how to colonize the other planets, that is exobiosis. So let us start with life. Life means jivaha, jivitam, jivanam, all of these various things that deal with the element that lives is known as jiva. And the process of life is known as jivana. The status of life, how we live, who is that? The style with which we live, that is known as jivita. So first it is understood, life has two dimensions. One is living, second is reproduction. So we are starting from such a point. Gynecology does not start with something. It starts with the atomic explosion of the basic universe. This explosion ends in formation of life. Life ends in self-processing and hindrance management, crisis control and risk management and balancing. While doing that, the second extension, to live and to create a life, is the second step. I've already told, to live and to create a life, that is known as reproductivity. To create a life, we require a force, that is known as a shakti or viryam, what we call, that is known as fertility. So the hierarchy or the systematic learning of processing of various things. Now if you see, in the first stage or phase of transition of understanding these, you have to study about the universal explosion, then the spatial evolution, then understanding of life. First phase. Second phase, what is life, how to process the life, and how to balance the life, how to produce a life. Four things. Second, how to have the conception, pregnancy and delivery. The pre-processing inside the womb of the mother and post-processing after the person is brought in various stages, physically, mentally, intellectually, emotionally and socially. So this starts with this fundamental, which is known as ontology. So fertility is the capacity of your person to produce an issue. And the fertility is also two types, fertile fertility and infertile fertility. Somebody we told Bahuputra Labham, there is a Vedic statement, Bahuputra Labham. It does not only mean Bahuputranam Labha, Bahuputra Labha. Putra Dwara Bahulapa Grahanam Bahuputra Labham Ityabi Vaktum Shakyate. So, getting a productive child, what is a productive child? With all qualities, physical perfection, mental perfection, emotional attachment, obedience, knowledge mastery, being a very sincere person to the home, a loyal person to the nation, a productive person to the globe. These are all the various factors which gives real fertility. And producing, just as pig produces piglets and cat produces kittens and dog produces puppies, it is just a normal reproductivity which is not fertility at all. Fertility is not only the capability to produce a child, it is the capability to produce a capable child. So this is how we have to understand the fertility process. So this is over. First we have started with life, reproduction and fertility. According to the science of life, there are three types of things. In Shastras we used to say Andaja, Pindaja, Shvetaja and Bijaja. Different types of this type of species are there. And in science they have just differentiated that it is isogamous, anisogamous and ciliates. Isogamous means they will be similar, but still they will be having functional difference. If they unite to form, that is known as isogamous production. It is asexual and sexual. And our productivity is very much absurdly, filthily understood as a sexual production. It is nonsensical. It is no doubt a sexual production, but it has lot of asexual fundamentals. The conviction, the desire, bahubhyam prajayeyam, bahusyam prajayeyam, Bagudha prajayeyam, anaya prasavishyadvam. There are lot of Vedic mantras which say that no doubt you might be knowing about automobiles. There will be a starter and runner. No doubt the runner is a sexual reproduction, but the starter is not like that. If it is there, then there won't be any difference between the human system and the other animal systems. So the asexual like budding and the binary fission which happens in the plants, innumerable types of systems are there, like mechagenesis, metagenesis, morphogenesis, oogenesis, spermatogenesis, theogenesis, parthenogenesis, innumerable genesis process are there. We must understand that the runner process is just common as all things are there. Just as we eat and we excrete and we do things very much common with the animal kingdom, we do the same thing. But still, it has a basic where it is different by three things. One is sankalpa, second is vrata, third is samarpana. If these things are not done, it makes the pregnancy makes no difference from that of a dog or any other animal in the creation of God. What is sankalpa? Both of them, those who are willing to unite, they must have a strong desire which must be attributed to the divine will that they must have a child which will do what are all the good things that are done by us, number one, which will not do the bad things which are done by us, number two, which will do the good things better than us, number three, number four, what are all the leftover things, it will be done by those things, that avaseshana will be totally exhausted, number fifth, whatever we have forgotten to know or to execute, that will be reminded and executed by child. So a child must have these five qualities. It is known as sankalpa. Yadad acharitam punyam tasya acharanaya, yadad papam acharitam tasya khandanaya dhvamsanaya cha, yadyate alpam acharitam uchyate tasya kramashaha acharanaya, yadyate vismritam ajnatam cha तस्य क्रमः शनैः शनैः आचरणाय लोकस्य उद्धारकः पितृणामपि उद्धारकः पितृकुलस्य उद्धारकः स्वकुलस्य क्षेमङ्करः कश्चन पुत्रः तत्र उत्पद्येत इति दम्पत्ति समेतस्य पुरुषोत्तमस्य सपत्नीकस्य पुरुषोत्तमस्य सन्निधौ सङ्कल्पकपूर्वक ध्यानं क्रियते तदनन्तरमेव प्रजोत्पत्तिः इति सङ्कल्पद्वारा स्वेतर समस्त जंतूनां शिशुत्पत्ति प्रक्रिया व्यावृत्तिः अत्र संदृश्यते. सो बाय दिस प्रोसेस संकल्प, द संकल्प इज वेरी मच essential and it is very potential also in the manner we are just distinguishable from the other species. This is sankalpa. And the third thing I have already told, samarpana. The child must be immediately entrusted towards the God and divine protection. Then between this period there is a vrata. What is vrata? Taking a risk and also leaving our desire is known as vrata. Taking your desire and leaving all risk, that is a merry way of living your life, that is known as rejoicement. What is vrata and what is your way of the sukha in the world? Vrata and sukha, they are contrary to each other. But the problem is the so-called sukha will end in dukkha. This vrata will end in sukha. Even though it may start in the abdication of your desires and your understanding or your adaptation of something which may be arduous, Herculean or risky to you, it ends in desire. Real desire, real fructification of your desire in the form of not only happiness to you, it is a long-term happiness, real happiness. When the child is there, you are carrying the child inside your womb, you are saying that he is kicking and you are happy. When you are carrying him in your hands, he is kicking, you are happy. Then when he is grown up, he is doing the same kicking, you are not happy. At the age of 20 or 30, he is powerfully making a volleyball game inside the house. Now you are not happy. So that is known as vrata. Taking a determination in which we do everything. That is what the Vedas say. Just as a pregnant lady totally abdicates her desires, wants and unwanted elements, totally depends upon the salubrity of the child and acts according to that, we are also having God in our Hridaya Garbha. Hridayam tat vijaniyat vishvasyayatanam hat. Each and every devotee, as God is there in the Hridaya Garbha, he should not act upon his limited desire or unwanted unpleasant things as per his calculations, but he must act as per the ordinance of divinity, ordinance of eternity and purity. So this is the process by which one should beget their progeny, and that is known as progeny. This science is known as progenics. So it must start with a sankalpa. It must be conducted as a vrata, and as soon as the product is there, the harvest is there, it must be submitted to the divinity. So that which is sankalpa, vrata, samarpana purvaka, that is the real cause, that is the real purpose, and there is a real system of progeny. That's why I want to say. Then fertility, we are going to discuss about those things also. The third thing is fertility. I have already told about these things. There are three stages. One is the decisive stage, and the second is the executive stage, and third is the processive stage. Processive stage consists of two steps. One is endoprocessing, second is exoprocessing. And endoprocessing is processing inside your womb, embryo. And this exoprocessing is by three steps. One is pre-lactative stage, second is post-lactative stage, and the third thing is mature stage, that is known as emotional attachment. The first thing is known as lactic attachment. Second thing is known as sensual attachment. Third thing is known as emotional attachment. If at the time of giving milk, that is payasambandha, we used to say, at the time of giving milk, you must also feed your feelings. Communicate with your feelings, not as the medley of your feelings. You will be having a variety of feelings, distress, despair, disappointment, frustration. You must not feed everything to the child. It is a selective feeding. Selective feeding, do you have the art of selective feeding? No. We cannot feed our thoughts like that. We don't have that art at all. We have not been properly trained. So, we are mixing. For example, we used to say, if you mix sugar and sand, immediately if you just, who can just segregate it very precisely? Only the row of ants. If they go, they can very precisely do that. You cannot do that. Can you suck honey from flowers? You can suck from Dabur bottle. You cannot get directly suck from the flower, because they are so minute and so delicate that your megastructure or macroscopic organs are not besuited enough to deal with the deal. Isn't it so? So, this type of selective feeding of the wanted qualities may be possible only by three things. One is diksha, initiation, upasana, contemplation. Third is anugraha, benediction. Either you must have a special training for you. And the training cannot be done. See, if some train, there is already I told it in one upanyasa, apatkale vahana vyasavat. If somebody is chasing you, if you want to get a train, then the running must not be started, but running must not be just put in abhyasa at the time when it is moving fast. When it is just slowly proceeding, at the time you have to catch it. And second thing is, if some thief is chasing you, you must not just get the training inside a car driving institute or a bullet driving institute, how to drive a bullet and how to get escaped. Already you are well acquainted with the process of handling the bullet with speed, you can avoid the thief and you can escape from him, isn't it so? So, that's why all of these things must be taught in the impressionable age itself. No doubt we are happy that we are not late than but the other people are there. When we compare ourselves with the many members of the society, certainly we are not late. But still, when we compare to that of our tradition, these things are taught at a very, taught and processed at a very impressionable age itself. So, it is a right time, instead of taking more delay or procrastination, we have to process ourselves by these things. Either we have to go for an initiation or by a contemplation, by a process of thinking about God, by a mantra or a particular system of worship, which may be with a form, without form, with mantra or without mantra. But if you have a form, mantra and everything, we shall have a grip. We have not been acquainted with a formless, vague, cryptonymous and anonymous spirit. So, for catching something with a grip, to have a proper clutching on an entity and purpose, we must have some specification, mantra, murti, dhyana, paddhati, everything, etc. Then benediction of great people, that is ashir vachana of great people and great radiations, they are also very much important. So, this particular time is very much essential and it is very indispensable for us to learn these things. So, first I have told, number one, when we are processing outside, we are processing with the milk. The second stage, we are feeding. Each and every touch of the mother, each and every touch of the mother, sight of the mother, that is Vikshana Diksha, or Vikshana Pravesha, or Vikshana Vyapti. One is Vikshana by seeing, by touching, by calling, by laughing, by smiling, by crying, by holding, by embracing. There are innumerable things. You see, the heart of the child, the anahata of the child is in embrace. It is just locked with the anahata of the mother. And whenever the child is put like this, that is madhyastha or antastha or uparistha, there are three stages of holding the child. That is in Dakshina Bhaga or in Vama Bhaga. These six stages, they have their own processing inside. If it is in the Manipuraka, the child understands the speech of the mother. If it is in anahata, that understands the feelings of the mother. If it is there in the head or this ajna, whether it may be this dakshina palaka or this vama palaka, then the child understands the intellect of the mother. So intellect of the mother, feelings of the mother and words of the mothers are understood. And all of the feelings, whether they are the positive feelings, understanding the feelings of greatness, pride, these things are possible in the right embracement. Understanding the agony, depression, craving, expectation of mother is possible in the vama. That is the left side. So it is a very great, even this alingana, matru alingana, it has lot of psychological contact. It is a physio-psychological process. The touching, holding, embracing, kissing, each and everything is an act of divine bliss. It is an act of divine knowledge. It is an act of divine radiation that is in the form of communication between both of them. As they are composed of the same biological bulk, composed of the same configuration, they have the lineage, attraction and affinity also, they can communicate more. So first is the milk giving age, and the second stage is food giving age, wherein by you feed, touch, you dress and do everything. You follow that? The first stage is extremely dependent, second thing is semi-dependent, third thing is independent. So the mother, very much we have to know that, extremely dependent, then dependent, semi-dependent and independent. When it is inside, even for respiration, it is dependent on mother. So that is extremely dependent. Then at the lactic stage, it is dependent. At the stage wherein by some nourishment is given, dress is given, then the snana and other various other decorations and beautifications are done by the mother. At the stage it is semi-dependent, shortly it is growing. Then it is well grown, then it says bye-bye and go to school, and one day it says a very big bye-bye so that it does not look after the mother at all, turn over at all. So these type of four stages, what I want to tell is, you note down this golden point which may be known to both of you, both the patients as well as the doctors in pregnancy. You can have the control of your child 99%, 1% you have to give to God, 99% you can have a control when it is extremely, totally dependent. 75% you can give when it is dependent. 50% you can control when it is semi-dependent. When it is grown and becoming dependent, you can control 25%. If it is extremely independent, you cannot control at all. Then you have to obey, or you have to search the second son's house if you have one. So these are all the various stages. What we have to do? There are two tasks. There are only two tasks. One is known as positivity feeding. What is it known as? Positivity feeding. Second thing is negativity extirpation. What is positivity feeding? There are basic things which are known as peripheral things. What is required before delivery, during pregnancy? What is required during inception, before pregnancy? What is delivered before the inception at the time of the decisive stage? They must have a good mental harmony. They should have a proper physical salubrity. And there must be the timing also. According to Shastras, there is in the progenics, there is a science known as progenical temporalism or temporoprogenics, which deals with the muhurtas being Rakshasa, Asura, Paishacha, Sura, Deva, Gandharva, Manusha, Atimanusha, Mrita. So all of these muhurtas are there in our ancient chart, which has been totally forgotten. You know that Kashyapa Prajapati was the only one father for both the Devas and Asuras. He is the only father. Their mothers were different because their impregnation was done in a different timing. Provided that the timing being Asuric in nature, that has produced this Dithis, Putras, Daityas and Adityas of the Devata, they have been produced in the Satvika Kala. So we must know about these timings. Either I think that somebody should work it out and cull it out from the ancient, hidden, obsolete and partially available scriptures and form a tabulation. There are two tabulations. One is a general tabulation, second is a specific tabulation. General tabulation that gives the total competence of time. The Rakshasa, Paishasa, Achurika, Gandharva, Saura, all of these things are given generally. Specific tabulation deals with the compatibility of the time as per the star or the physical status or the intellectual status or any other paraphernalia of a person, and its suitability, subjectability and revisability of the time. That is a subjective chart which is supposed to be specifically mentioned for each and every person. It must be a customized product. So second thing is a general, second thing is customized as per the caliber or configuration of the producer or the primogenitor and his associate. So this must be very much essentially made. So positivity must come from various things. Basically, it comes from food. Second, it comes from rest. Third, it comes from meditation. Fourth, it comes from love. Fifth, it comes from time. Sixth, it comes from the most possible way of reducing or minimizing your medication is very much essential in pregnancy. The minimum you consume medicines, the maximum the benefits are there, because whatever that induces, hormones, enzymes, our sensations like psychotropic drugs or antibiotics, those things may be salubrious for health, but not for the health of the child, and it will consume and erode the intellectual development and spiritual maturity. So food is very much essential, nutritious food, and salubrious and energy-oriented food, which creates dynamism. Not flesh-building food, but that will build dynamism. And second thing is, good rest must be there. If the person has no rest, even before productivity, at the course of pregnancy and after delivery also, I'm saying that. Still they are having some vibrations and vibrant connectivity, so they must have proper rest. They have to sacrifice. I want to say one thing. If you want such a successful child, such a showing, glowing, shining child in the society, only great things are produced out of sacrifice, not by just joy. Joy must be the product of sacrifice. Only that joy, that is an outcome of sacrifice, that gives you permanent joy. Otherwise, the other joys will be just like the joy which starts with drinking and gambling, which ends in untold miseries. So sacrifice must be there. So I am going to office. Somebody told we went for some pumsavana. I told that she must not go to vehicle. She must not go to vehicle at all. She must not drive anything at all. Because while driving, lot of other minute inceptions are there. Wherever we see a vehicle, immediately we are having a shock. While in traffic jam, when we are overriding somebody, somebody is overriding somebody, and when we are being chased by somebody, and when there is a problem or congestion, when there is a congestion or traffic jam, immediately we lose patience. We are frustrated. Then there is a perspiration, tension, anxiety. They must not go to business at all. If they are HR leader, they have to take care of the headaches of all the persons in the department. So the more tension, the more restlessness, impatience, anxieties, perplexity, these things totally, this is just 1 rupee. A second of perplexity for a pregnant lady is just 1 rupee. But totally, at the time of pregnancy, unavoidably in domestic, social, academic, professional, and various other go and come grounds, she will lose at least 1 or 2 millions at all. You just calculate like that. So you must sacrifice. And I don't know how much of people will be subservient to the Vedic rules. Anybody must take it as a penance. According to our Shastras, desiring a good child, receiving a good child, begetting a good child and processing as a good child, it is a divine boon, and that is a work of God, not work of human beings. So it is a penance. So they must abdicate, they must relinquish all of their other, they want to have everything. She must earn, she must go and work, and they must also have a good child. All of these things are not unanimously possible, to my humble opinion, and as per the ordinance of the Vedic scriptures, we have to realize that. So positivity is initially built by this food, rest, relaxation, and love. The more love that you confirm between yourself, that you transfer between yourself, that yields more benefit, that process the child more to be good in good emotional response. If both of you love here and there, I am telling you one thing, if both of you love each other and transform the same love to your child, whenever you cry here, even though it may be due to peeling of onion or smoke intrusion, immediately it will have a response there. So that biological configuration, if they are emotionally binded, because when a child who is emotionally and biologically attached for 10 months, it is separated biologically. Only way of attachment is emotional. That time you cannot create emotion, because the child is independent or semi-dependent, and it is well processed. A pot can be well made only when the clay is wet. If it becomes taptabhanda, then you cannot do any process changing. Because when it is inside, when it is tender, and when that is responsive to you, if you cry immediately, that person will also cry. You have not produced such a child. Then after 10 years or 15 years, you are crying that he is not obedient, and you are enjoying, my son is very angry. You know that he will totally, if he is angry, he will totally crush all the teapots. or he will kick me. He won't mind even his father. He will scold like anything. So you are enjoying all of these mischievous activities or unwanted aberrant activities at the level of a small bud. Then if it is growing as a grand giant, then that is taking the magnificent form of Vishwarupa at the well-developed age. Then they were worrying and lamenting about these things to the neighbors, strangers and all other unwanted people. So positivity must also be a process. How many processes are there? One is ritualistic process. That is a Homa Sukta. It is known as Prajanana Sukta. Why we are known as Prajas? All are known as Praja. All are not known as Prajas. Praharshena Jayate Iti Praja. Praharshakaram Janma Yasya Sa Praja. Who is born out of the bliss and who is blissful to the society, that person is known as Praja. Prajananam. Prajananam, getting good child is also one pathway to emancipation. Getting liberation is very difficult. There are 12 ways given in the Taittiriya Upanishad. Satyam tapo damashamas danam dharma prajananam agnayo agnihotram yagyo mana samnyasaha. There are 12 ways. Prajananam, getting good children. If you don't do anything, you get a good child, he will take you to a proper way. Aspotayanti pitaraha pranatyante pitamahaha vaishnavo nakule jataha sanasantarishyati. If a good child, a devotee is born in a family, all the pitrus, all the ancestors, they are just clapping their hands and dancing. Oh, he has come in that family. Certainly he is going to uplift us. Similarly, we are going to immediately reach an abode of perfection and bliss. So everybody is happy, not only the parents, also the successors and even the predecessors. They are emancipated, they are glorified and upgraded. So rituals are there. Those who are believing in rituals, they can do that prajana, homa and other things. Second is contemplative. Santana Gopala Krishna is a very simple god. He is a very simple god. Instead of going to Narasimha, Varaha Bhagavan and everybody, then it is very difficult because they are not having public attraction. Krishna and Rama, they are having public attraction. Rama is having respect in the society. Varaha is having regard in the society. Narasimha is having fear in the society. Krishna is having love and romance in the society. So Santana Gopala Krishna is highly adorable and worshipable God for all of us. So immediately we can see, we must not think that God suffered like that. And Krishna also suffered and Rama suffered. We must understand that it is akratunyaya. What is tatkratunyaya in Shastra? Yatha upasate tathaiva palamashrute. Whatever you think, you will get the same result. It is known as tatkratunyaya. Or tatkratunyaya or akratunyaya is, you will get a different result at all. Is it a natural act or any human intrusion? Akratunyaya. What is atatkratu or akratunyaya? For example, I will say one simple example. Krishna, he was binded by a rope by Yashoda. But if you read the story, you will not be binded. And on the contrary, you will be released from bondage. That's why Vedanta Deshika, he told, whoever reads the story of Krishna having drunk the milk of Putana, once again he will not be born for a mother and drink mother's milk. He will be totally liberated. So, Krishna has suffered. Krishna is mischievous and Krishna is divine. But whatever it may be in his productive status, we are receptacles. He will give just what we want. He will not give whatever he has. He knows what we want. So Santana Gopala Krishna, in spite of his mischiefs and divinity, and even though the incarnations are subject to different miseries, by worshipping them, we will not get miseries, we will not get anything mischievous, and we will getting something which is divine in nature, which is very much useful for the society. So there is a shloka in Shastra, Vipraputra Bharata Chaiva Sarvamatru Sutaprata Partha Vishmayakrit Partha Pranavartha Prabodhanaha. It is a Mula Mantra for Santana Gopala Krishna. So Krishna, he gave issues to those who worship him, number one. Number two, he also brought back the life of Parikshit, who was already dead, and also brought back the issues of Shantipini Maharishi, who have been killed before few years at all. So Krishna gives good progeny. Krishna gives natural progeny without any process of cesarean or hyper seclusion, etc. And he gives a progeny with longevity. He also saves our progeny from immoral bindings and death and other miseries. So it is very much essential for us to say at least Om Namo Bhagavate Santana Gopalaya Sarva Matru Suta Pradaya Shrimate Namaha. Very simple it is. So once it is known as role model. You have to possess the photo of Santana Gopala. You must regularly see that instead of seeing the cine stars and politicians and other useless timsels of the society, it is better to have a model or divine inspiration which will mold the child inside. It is known as contemplative process number two. And apart from this contemplation and other things, I have already told benediction. We must get lot of benedictions from people. Suputravati bhava, Saubhagyavati bhava. We must hear good words, Vedic recitation, good wishes from good people. And the second is a radiant charge. Getting good words from good people is known as benedictory charge. Second charge is radiant charge, which we get from Punya Tirthas, Kshetras, everything, etc. Get from good people, that is known as radiant charge. But that is running, this is not running. Shall I sit there then? No problem, I can sit anywhere.
No, it will start.
It's ritualistic. Second thing is contemplative. Third thing is benedictive, the charge. And fourth thing is radiant charge that we are getting from that. And fifth thing is eco-ambience. At the time of this delivery and pregnancy, we must live in an area of ambience. See, whenever we want to get great things, we must not mind three. We must have three and we must not have three. We must not mind energy. We must not mind investment of energy, investment of time and money. I won't spend anything and I am not ready to do anything, but I want a child who is going to rule for 100 years. How it is possible? So, one must not mind time, energy, risk and other things. And they must have faith, sincerity. They must have first faith in the system. Then sincerely they have to follow that system at all. Third, they must have the willpower even in the time of hurdles. These three things must be there and three things must not be minded. It is very much essential in these things. So eco-ambience, there are two things. One, shift your persons to an area of ambience or create an artificial ambience by sound, by pictures, by bringing good people or taking to good areas. That is known as eco-ambience. And the other thing is known as domestic conduciveness. At that time, they must not be quarreling with each other. They must not bring quarreling agents in the form of relatives and create chaos in the house. At that time only somebody will take a special interest in quarreling and discussing and finalizing issues. No confidence motion will be implemented at that time only. So domestic conduciveness. And the second thing is social conduciveness. That is academic, professional and various other areas. Wherever you move with, you must move with such an area. So if somebody is taken to a remote place or a village or a resort or a mountain, they will get good children. At least on an experimental basis, it is not possible because they will lose money if they just come out of the office. And after coming out of the office, losing money and also spending money somewhere else for their care, it is totally unimaginable for those people. But it is not like that. It is a prudential investment. It is not spending or expenditure at all. Whatever you invest in the form of money or whatever you are believing that you are losing by abdicating your business or shifting yourself, that is a prudential investment which will mature in the form of an aurific issue. What is aurific? What is auriferous in English? That which is harvested as gold is known as auriferous. You will get an aurific issue. That is a greatness. So, contemplative, ritualistic, eco-ambience, then salubrity, physical health. Fifth is family or domestic conduciveness. Sixth is social conduciveness. Seventh is known as the radiance charge. And eighth is known as benedictory charge. These eight things are the processes meant for positivity feeding. And one more great topic I am going to say, which is known as inheritance. What is inheritance? To get something from somebody. I am financially poor and I am in a crunch. I am getting money from a rich person. Rich person who is merciful. And I am totally impotent. I am seeking the support and guidance of a potential person. I am totally not knowledgeable. I am seeking the guidance of a knowledgeable person. So inheritance is adaptation of qualities. There are four types of inheritance. One is immediate inheritance or inheritance. Second is remote or distant inheritance. And third thing is adaptive inheritance. And the fourth thing is confederate inheritance. What is immediate inheritance? The people having the children resembling their characters and features and faces and structures, that is immediate resemblance. That is immediate resemblance. It may be physical, it may be functional, it may be partial, it may be absolute, it may be in the case of twins, or it may be in the case of twins with heterogenic in nature or homogenic in nature, homo resemblant or heterogenic in nature, it may be twins or trins or quadrupins or multiples. There are innumerable things. Our Vedas, they have innumerable things. Gandhari, according to our Puranas, she had 100 children without any babysitter's club and their facilities. They have just to foster the children and nourish them. Number two, it is known as rapid processing. What is it known as? Rapid processing. Rishi Garbha Naratri Sthiyate. If the rishis and rishi patnis, if they are conceiving, immediately the next day dawn, they will be having the issue, delivery. There is a special rule. And there is parthenogenesis. You know that without the support, just as it is in the bees family, without the support of the male or female counterpart, a single gender can produce, it can have a multisexual system inside, which can produce an issue of the kind, which is the requirement of a combat or communion with the issue of the opposite sex. It is there. So our shastras have a lot of other things that we will discuss later. And according to shastras also, this inheritance, there are few more divisions of inheritance. One is absolute inheritance. Totally inheriting somebody, that must be a divine blessing. And second thing is partial inheritance, I have already told. One more, there is a difference. One is benevolent inheritance. Second is malevolent inheritance. Third is known as ambivalent inheritance. What is benevolent? Inheriting good qualities, like he is a good musician. How it is there? What is known as a genetic adoption? The father's father is a good musician in sitar. Then when the chromosomal arrangement are there, or the gene transfer or the gene qualitative transfer occurs in the lineages, this musician, the quality of his musical splendor or dexterity, it passes through the next generation. That adaptivity, that adaptation or adaptivity, it says that no, I don't want that. It is rejecting that. So it does not enter inside the son. For the other, but it resides. It is not manifested, but it resides. There are two things. One is residential status, second is manifesting status. If your grandfather is a great musician in sitar, then it must have come to your father. But due to incompatibility, it was just residing in him without being manifested. As you are having that compatibility, you can just join that with that, then you are becoming a musician representing your father. Somewhere it is there with your father, somewhere with your mother, somewhere it may be with your uncle, remote relations, somebody it may be with your distant relatives like forefathers, then their grandfathers, great grandfathers, it may be there. Even somebody must have inherited the qualities of the primogenitor like Kashyapa, Atri, Bhrigu, Pulastya. They are all the Rishikalpas. They are Rishiprayas. Those people are very rarely found in the society, you know that. So, this type of inheritance is there. What is, why you are teaching this? Good things are got from benevolent. And malevolent gives all the bad things. Instead of being a musician, the same qualities of a drunkard or a killer or a psychopath, it is totally inherited by a child or grandchild. That is known as malevolent. Then ambivalent means it inherits both. Why I am teaching all of these things? Because there are two options. One is obligatory. You cannot do anything. You cannot do anything at all. It is totally inherited. Second thing is selective. You are having the option of selecting things. Whenever you want the quality of your ancestor, you can order that. Whenever you want to cancel the quality of your ancestor, you can get that. Then also, external adaptation. Whenever you want the quality of an external person who is not genetically related with you, a good musician, for example, Ravi Shankar, he is not your relation. But from that, you can have the inspiration, not from Ravi Shankar, because those people are knowledgeable. See, what is the difference between knowledgeable people and great personalities, worshipable personalities? Respectable personalities are having knowledge or some great principle. Worshipable personalities are the persons, those who just not only have that, but one who can transmit the radiation by the touch and wish and will. So that is the difference between respectable persons and worshipable persons. By their will, by their connective will, sankalpa, by their icha, by their tapasya, they can transfer. Whereas the other people, they can teach, tutor, train you, or you can they can give you an address where a good person can teach you in a better way. That is the difference between. The society is now troubling because, troubling others and struggling for them because they are all worshipping respectable people and having just respect with worshipable personalities. Those who want just to be paid respect, they are no worship like gods. No doubt if there is a good musician, don't just respect him. Why you are worshipping? There are great worshipable people in the world, in this land. There are a lot of people with knowledge of Upanishads, Shastras, are following the roots of the ancient wisdom. They are totally worshipable. We follow that. So we are having such a system of selectivity wherein by you can cancel unwanted qualities, you can invite wanted qualities, or you can also adopt qualities which are not there in your lineage or not known in your lineage from other people who are known through history or experienced by your personal vision, subjectivity and perceptibility. So this is known as selection. It is very much essential here. So in this basic area, there are three qualities which are told in three different sciences. That science separately we have to conduct a class and we have to frame a Bachelor of Science syllabus. The first thing is known as bioarchitecture. Second thing is known as theoeugenics. Third thing is known as genetic tailoring. And there are two sciences in the world. Now it is there eugenics, but that is in struggle with bioethical issues. And we are having genetic tailoring, just as you go to the tailor and order for your robe. We can also order for a good child. Just as you are saying that I want a pocket here, and I want a sleeve here, I want a rope here, not here. Everything you can also say that I want a child, that too to be a good mathematician with brownish eyes, 5.6 tall, everything you can give. And they are planning to make a genetic tailoring shop. And there are also bioethical issues, they are struggling. But according to Vedas, there is a harmonious, illustrious, trouble-free, systematic and harmless way of making this theoeugenics and this genetic tailoring. What is bioarchitecture? You know that? It is a very wonderful subject. Bioarchitecture is a very wonderful subject. Tvatta yonim vishatu vishtur yonim kalpayatu, so says the Veda. Vishnu is creating the yoni, that is the garbhapinda. And the primary mark which is to be manifested at the first month is made by Tvashta, Vishwakarma. You know, Vishwakarma is a sculptor. He, apart from making the architecture of a house, there is temple architecture, there is iconography, there is cosmetology, personal beautification, personality development, everything is a form of various types of architecture or designing. He makes inside the womb also, Vishwakarma goes inside and he creates five things. One, what are all the angas to be present? What are all the organs to be present? Number one, Anga Vaishadhyam. Then, Parimanam. What are all the size, shape and personal proportionate ratios to be maintained between those various parts of the body? That is Pramanam and Parimanam. And the third thing is Vaikalyam. Where are all the objectives that are there to be made, either as a handicapped structure where it is not available or available in a shorter size or may have projected? There are two problems which are there in three issues, not available and available. Not available means totally handicapped, either structurally not available, but available not functionally working, that is not available. Even available, that will be smaller in size or extra projective in size. This type of bioarchitecture is made by Vishwakarma inside. Tattayo nimbishatu. So in the bioarchitecture, he makes Vaiparitya, something which is extraordinary, Sadrishya, something that is resembling your uncle, your mother, father or grandfather, some portions. Vairakshanya, something very distinguishable from them. Vyavritta, something very different from them. All these five things he makes. So he makes the angas and anga pramanas along with the anga virupas. Then also the Vaiparitya, where it must be different, where it must be distinguishable, where it must be similar, resembling with these people. So this resemblance, disparity, distinguishability, either Nyunata or Adhikya, either mega projection or micro sizing, or structure, styling, shaping and sizing, everything is made in the womb by the bioarchitecture made by the Vishwakarma as per the injunctions, inviolable injunctions of Vishnu. So this is bioarchitecture. Second thing is theoeugenics. By prarthana we can bring. By prarthana you know that Vasudeva and Devaki, they have made that prarthana for God, so that God himself, he is incarnated in that womb, making it more divine. So even though we are not getting God, we can get God sent, godly, God loving, God fearing, God serving denizens for the society. Who can promote ourselves and promote the society at all? So from today, we have to make a prarthana that we must have a God-sent, godly, God-loving, God-fearing and God-serving progeny for all of us. That is known as theo-eugenics. And genetic tailoring. In genetic tailoring, you can adopt all of these things. There are five prarthanas, which I will simply say, you can note down. What are the unwanted qualities which may be automatically inherited? We want them to be extirpated. What are the wanted qualities known to us or unknown to us with our predecessors or with me? Let that be inherited. Whatever the wanted qualities that I do not see or know from my lineage, which I can have a selection from the wider community, let it be imbibed inside. And we can also design lot of things. What are all the selective designs you can do? You know that? You can select the gender of the child. You can select the complexion of the child. You can select the height of the child. You can select the pupil and iris level and status of the child. Apart from which, longevity, physical health, knowledge status, emotional attachment, obedience, principles of rituals and rites, systematism, emancipation, till mukti, we can design everything if we properly organize it as pratha, a tapasya, which must be done with the mutual consent of both of the people, with unanimity, uniformity and unity. Then only they can bring these issues. So apart from this theogenetics, theo-eugenics and genetic tailoring and this bioarchitecture studies which I have told, have you noted down these 5 points? So apart from all of these major issues, now let us come to the Vedic way of getting good children, the Vedic sanskaras, and also the Ayurveda Shastra and other things. You know that obstetrics is the science that deals with the pregnancy care and proper delivery and everything. You know that there are innumerable problems. So whenever a person gets into pregnancy, there are 5 things. One is changes in the body, and second thing is problems in the body, third thing dangers to the body, fourth thing is medication to the body, fifth thing is surgery or medical implications to the body. Medication and implications to the body. So you know that according to Shastras and also to modern science, there are 6 major differences or changes according to the eugenics as well as the obstetrics. It starts with the change in our cardiovascular system. Then there is a metabolic change. There is a renal change. So each and every change, it is very natural. There is a physical change. First, it starts with a physical change, physical movement change. So all of these various changes are occurring. And what is the connectivity between these changes and getting a good issue? That is the thing which we are going to tell. Whenever these changes are unavoidable and nobody is going to prevent these changes, whenever there is a change process inquired, then it must be supplied with an extra energy which we cannot get from vegetables or green leaves. For example, they used to say that folic acid, nutrition, obesity, imbalances and our basic inheritance of our resistance power, these 4 things are like 4 pillars of pregnancy, which we used to say. The basically they used to say for nutrition, folic acid. That is why we used to say Yava is known as Godhuma. Yava is known as Godhuma. That is a wheat. They used to say that it is a benevolent parasite. So it imbibes energy and there is a loss of energy. That loss of energy, you must understand, cannot be compensated by folic acid, lactic acid or green leaves and everything. That should be compensated only by tapasya, pratha, by determination. That cannot be compensated by anything at all. You must understand this thing, changes. Then what are all the basic problems for our body? Immediately you will get constipation. Then frequency of urination. Then back pain. Then after other things are there. I am not experienced. So these are all difficulties. Then dangers. There are a lot of dangers. Diarrhea, it is amenorrhea. Dysenorrhea is there. And menorrhagia is there. What is menorrhagia? Getting most pain in menstrual discharges. Getting more pain. The most pain. Intolerable, excruciating pain. And getting imbalanced intervals. Not getting menstruation at all. Getting frequency in menstruation. All of these things are very dangerous. It results also in infertility. Then immediately they will go for some process for removal of the uterus, removal of the ovary. I want to say something. If the uterus is removed, uterus is not only having the purpose of bearing the child, it has some gravity balance inside the body. If it is removed, immediately the people will get arthritis, nephritis, urites and all other diseases, because it balances the gravity of the body. They are thinking that, the scientists are thinking that it is only for bearing the child. As soon as you don't require a child or you cannot bear a child, you have to remove it. So Johnson, the great surgeon, he told, a real surgeon and a capable surgeon is not the person who can do it successfully, but who knows how to avoid it the most. That was a statement of Dr. Johnson. Likewise, we always advocate, there are a lot of other things in the form of Ayakanta Chantura. There is Ayakanta Chantura in Siddha and Ayurveda, and there is Prasavasava is there, Prasava Natakaya Lehya is there, Sindhu Madhuri is there, innumerable such things are there for post-pregnancy, pre-pregnancy and for most hematological diseases and deficits. There are a lot of other things are there which can safeguard our uterus from being operated. So this operation, immediately they will go for this laparotomy, laparoscopy, all of other things they are having for understanding these things. Immediately they will go for sonograph records, they will identify that they cannot cure it immediately. If they cannot cure it, that must not be inside. So immediately they are operating, unless it is cancerous and it is beyond the control. I want to say that I am not against surgery. It is a blessing in the world. But I believe 85% of the surgeries are avoidable by the doctors. And 14% of the surgery is avoidable by the patients if we were vigilant earlier. Only 1% we have to do surgery. So this is what we calculate. Now let us conclude the section by saying about communication. What is communication? You know, communication is nothing but passing a message. Anybody can pass a message to anybody. You can just, while going on the way, you can see the sun and stars or moon, you can say that don't come tomorrow. Anybody can pass the message to anybody. He can write to George Bush, resign your job. Anybody can pass. But effective message is sending a message which is productive to a person who is responsive, which is coming in the form of effective stage. So it must be having a productive release. It must be having a productive release to a responsive person for an effective end. So that which starts with a productive person, goes to a responsive person, comes to an effective end is known as real communication. Just like if you are talking towards yourself or talking to wall and other things, it is schizophrenic in nature. So real communication is very potential. Now I am talking about the communication. There are three types of communications. One is the communication of love between the male and female. Second is the communication of the mother towards the womb, and communication of the father towards the mother, and mother towards the father, and father towards the womb. There are four communications. One is known as paternal fetal communication, maternal fetal communication or embryo communication, then maternal paternal communication, paternal and maternal communication. How to communicate with this child inside? Is it in the form of emotion, or it is in the form of a sense, or how it is possible? How we can communicate with the child? Child, can it understand some language? I want to say a few words. Prahlada, he was initiated Om Namo Narayana. Then he was able to recite it. Dhruva was touched by the conch shell of Vishnu. Immediately he narrated shlokas. And the other thing is, while in the embryo of Uttara, while he was sleeping, this Abhimanyu was sleeping, the Padma Vyuha, that is the lotus missile structure, was inculcated. At the time he understood, but without understanding the process of breaking it, it is being told. All of those things give the possibility that child has a response. He does not give us the idea of the gravity of the response, depth of the response. From these stories you must not follow the depth of the response, because that happened between mega creatures or mega substances. That was Narada, this was Prahlada. And that was Abhimanyu and that was Arjuna. They are all Purana Purushas. That which happens between superior persons, superior communications, the depth of the communication was more deep in good gravity. That does not totally deny the process. We can also do, we must not expect that we can teach everything and the child will be coming narrating all of the shlokas which it has learnt in the womb. It is impossible. But it gives the basic idea that communication is possible. The womb, starting from, according to the Shastras, when the third month it occurs, when the organs are designed, when the Yoni Nishchaya, that is when the gender is designed, immediately God induces the Chaitanya. It is in Garbhopanishad. Then the child, it starts worshipping and glorifying God. It starts realizing God and everything. Immediately, Vishnu, he creates a Sutika, a Vayu, that is, it is a strong wind. It is known as in the form of Sutika. Then the Sutika Vayu, it turns, it reciprocates the child forgets everything, just being born as a very normal issue, known of anything, totally nescient, totally curtailed and curdled. So it comes in that form. So according to Shastras, there is some sense of response from children. How to communicate? There are four types of communication. One is thought. Second is touch. Third is transfer. Fourth is teach. Touch the child. The more you touch the child, it can just get some benefit. Then think about the child. Daily you think about the child taking a good time like Brahma Muhurta. Early morning, when the child's mind is having a balanceable status for subjective communication, you take the time. So touch and thought. Teach, you repeat things. Transfer, think that whatever you have, let it go. If you think that whatever you have should go, it is known as transfer. If you just narrate by your mouth and insist, it becomes teaching. If you say that, let my child be good, it is known as transfer. You must be good, that is imperative, that is teaching. So follow both of these things. Do it by touch. So touch with your four fingers, not with this karatala. Touch with you, your four fingers, the two, slightly on the Manipuraka. That is on the Manipuraka, where the auditive, contemplative and cognitive area of the child will be there. So you must touch there and you must say with imperative mode and assertive or affirmative mode, let my child be honest. You be honest. At any time you must be honest. You will be facing hurdles. At the time also be brave and be honest. So teach whatever you want to teach. Whatever you are teaching now fruitlessly to grown children, you please try to teach them. It will be more effective and fruitful. So touch, teaching, transfer and thought. All of these four things are very much essential. This gives three skills. You are having three skills. All mothers are having three skills. Certainly we can have a separate class for that. Three skills are very wonderful skills. One is behavioral correction. Second is structure beautification. Third is shape rectification. By your communication, by your sankalpa and divine vratha, divine austerity, you can make, rectify the shape. Long nose, like a trunk of the elephant. Broad ears, resembling the same elephant or its sister or brother. So it is a shape rectification. If you want your child to have a definite and beautiful shape, you imagine the shape. There are two things. There are two things. It is very wondrous. It is a good opportunity for me to tell all of these things to you. I am very much feeling blissful and grateful to the society which has organized it, because you can do two things. First is known as Prarambhika Prakriya. Second is known as Uttirna Prakriya. In the first phase, you think of some child and impose the figure of your child on that. You follow that? You see the photo of any child and try to think that is the face of your child. That is Prarambhika. If the communication goes on, that photo which you have seen outside will fade away and you will see, suddenly I say that you will see the face, the body of the child which you are going to see after 6 months. It is an experiment, only you have to experiment it and so in Prarambhika, there are two things. One is Ruparopana, second is Rupa Pradarshana. In Ruparopana, you are just imagining a form for your child. And whenever you are feeding with your thoughts more and more, in the second phase, immediately you can see the face of your child without the requirement of any devices. Now these devices are there for confusing the people and going for female fratricide, abortion and unwanted things. These things are totally against ethical principles at all. That we need not worry about. That we can do that. So first thing is, what we can do? We can do shape rectification. We can rectify the shape. Like protruded teeth. Teeth will not be there, but the teeth base will be there. You can have a proper design of your child. Second is structure beautification. You can have the complexion. You can have the elegance. You can have the boldness. You can have the swiftness in functioning. Everything you can design there inside. Third thing is behavioral correction. You don't know how he is going to behave, but you know how a child should behave. You know that or not? You may not be knowing how your child will behave, but you know that how a child should behave. So, ahimsa, sarvabhuta daya, sarvendriya nigraha, jnana, dhyana, maryada, shaucha, all of these qualities are very common for all elite members of the society, enlightened, upgraded members of the society. These qualities you know. So you can contemplate on these qualities. Ojosi, ojo medha swaha, balamasi balam medha swaha, satyamasi satyam medha swaha. So a lot of mantras are there. Even we can contemplate in English or any other region languages. So This type of communication with your child gives you shape rectification. Then it's a style and structures beautification and behavioral correction. That process requires a very great lecture. So I have clearly told in the concluding remarks, I want to emphasize the same, that our process, it may be a runner which resembles the animals, but the starter is a divine spirit and it ends with the divine purpose. So we are great and we have to produce only great children. I wish and bless all the participants here to have the opportunity of getting God blessed, productive citizens for the society, who is ever engaged in the process of establishing morality and righteousness in the world and helping and serving to those people who are engaged in the process. Narayan, Narayan, Narayan.
And one, you talk about the three things. I forget the third one. First, you talk about the sankalpa, vrata, and third one is
samarpana.
Dedication.
If first point from that point, see.
I can say that, but you know that it is introduction lecture, I have to cover various topics.
No, but just...
Sankalpa is determination.
No, I am asking if some parents, now they have crossed that stage now. So is there anything
more
that they can do?
Yes, at any stage. Even after getting the children, there are a lot of samskaras where they can bind the children. But... certainly it is better to be before, even if it is after, it is not a loss. There are process for that.
And my second question is for your timer, for the Asura, and you talk about...
Yes, that requires... See, how can I give the total calendar in 1 hour lecture?
No, my question is that time is for the actually born of the birth of the baby or conception?
No. It is for the conception. It is the Garbhadana.
और यही एक शुरुआत थी नहीं, दिस इज जस्ट बिगनिंग. व्हाट ही सेड इज एंडिंग बिकॉज द टाइम इज फिनिशिंग, इज नॉट एंडिंग बिकॉज ही द टॉपिक इज एंडेड. व्हाई ही इज एंडिंग बिकॉज द टाइम. बट एवरी वर्ड कैन हैव अ डिफरेंट डिफरेंशिएशन. वेदर इट वॉज लाइक व्हाट ही आस्क्ड, बिहेवियरल करेक्शन. इफ यू जस्ट से बिहेवियरल करेक्शन, देयर कैन बी अ डिफरेंट different topic. Communication, no, the way he told ki HR only se karna, even just telling a communication, there can be a different session.